Live on Tape, Work in Progress, a World at Work podcast about work, life, and everything in between. With award-winning radio host Tom Alexander and Workspan's Not Safe for Work columnist Charles Epstein. Here are your hosts, Tom and Charles.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to Work in Progress. My name is Tom Alexander, and of course, as always, I'm joined by my good friend and co-host, Mr. Charles Epstein. Hey, Charles.
Hey, Tom. You know, today, as you know, we were scheduled to speak with soccer superstar Megan Rapinoe, who was the keynote speaker at the Pay Equity Conference in Philly. But unfortunately, she had to bail on all media interviews, presumably because she was overbooked. Too bad, as we had some great questions teed up.
Yes, on pay equity, soccer. I particularly wanted to ask, what's the mindset you take into a penalty kick? Everyone in the stadium is watching you, millions at home, and Megan just steps up, thinks for a moment, then decisively kicks the ball past the goalie into the net. It's pretty amazing, and I just wondered what the approach was.
Yeah, it was really amazing. Talk about ice water in the veins. It's like a free throw, I guess, but with someone there to defend it and with everything on the line. I tense up hitting a second serve in a tennis match. That means absolutely nothing. I could imagine if I had to hit it with someone trying to swap the ball out of my hands and a large check writing on it.
Yeah, I hear that. It's like if I were playing a sous chef at home and my wife tries wrestling away the fluting knife while I'm cutting up the veggies. You know, it's and I'm sure she's been tempted, but it hasn't happened yet. Put a big quotes around yet.
Yes, thankfully. You know, when we heard Megan was keynoting the conference, we knew we had to get her on the pod. We just had to get her on, you know, and as things got firmed up, we were told her time was going to be tight. And a couple of weeks ago, it seemed like it wasn't going to happen. But we were determined to make our case.
Yeah. And both big fans during the recent World Cup. And the first time I actually got into women's soccer was Mia Hamm and Brandi Chastain, those teams. And that was the first time I paid attention. But this team really was special. And Megan is a real compelling figure. So, you know, we just had to have her on.
Yeah. So really bummer. But I think it was last week, a week before that, we made a list of the reasons she had to do our show. So I think we should, you know, it would be kind of fun to just roll that out. Can we get a drum roll, Tom?
Of course.
Okay. Reason number one, we completely supported her choice in hair color as purple was clearly the superior option, considering all the other options.
Yes, pink, blue, green, though not necessarily in that order.
No, not necessarily. Reason number two, in the joyful aftermath of their winning the World Cup final, we joined the chance of equal pay watching from home.
Well, all right. Yeah, I can't say that I joined the chance exactly. Not that there's anything wrong with that, but I was sympathetic.
Reason number three, like Megan, we are also on record as preemptively rejecting an offer to visit the current White House, though we don't know why we'd be on the receiving end of such an offer anyway.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I consoled myself with a Big Mac, filet of fish, large fries, and a chocolate shake, and pretended I was at a Trump administration state dinner.
Yes, only the finest.
Yes.
Reason number four, we're big Portland fans, though a friend who lives there gets on my last nerve by sending weekly photos of menus from pot dispensaries showing the stunning range of options and affordable prices.
Yeah, no, I could see how that would be pretty annoying. Yeah.
Reason number five, we love to partner Sue Bird's brilliant, hilarious, and moving article in The Athletic on Megan called, quote, "The President Hates My Effing Girlfriend," end quote. But we were surprised to learn that few of our World at Work colleagues, including Scott, had read it. So in addition to the above, we helped expand her partner's readership.
Yeah, that was hilarious. Who knew Sue Bird was such a terrific writer? Funny to boot. So
yeah,
gotta love that.
Yeah, great combination. One of the best female point guards ever, and a great writer. And last but not least, my college-age daughter, who's not easily impressed, would have been impressed.
Well, with all due respect, my college-age son would have been more impressed with a visit from Marty Scorsese, but I take your point.
Yeah, so anyway, big disappointment that she couldn't join us, but maybe the conference and our World at Work colleagues made such an impression that she'll agree to join us for a future show.
Perhaps. I guess we'll have to wait and see. But yeah, major bummer. Still not going to take it personally. We still love Megan Rapinoe.
Yes, yes. Still big fans.
Absolutely. Huge fans. But it would have been nice.
Yeah, oh, well, not the end of the world. Although I may have to take her signed jersey down from my wall. But other than that, hey, it is what it is.
Well, you know, as my dad said, you never want to beat your heroes.
Yes, I've heard that. And actually, it's exactly why, in my great and unmatched wisdom, I cover all our mirrors in the house. But a bit.
Ah, very good. Your unmatched wisdom, yes.
Yes. Yes. So to quote a great man.
Yes, I understand that. I understand that. So great guest today with Heidi Luerra, and we're looking forward to speaking with her. That's coming up next right here on Work in Progress. He's Charles Epstein. I'm Tom Alexander. Back right after these words. Do when you need external HR expertise, head on over to World at Work's vendor directory, kind of like the Yelp of HR, but without the biases. It's where to turn when you're looking for resources and providers in the world of HR. From legal services to compensation management, to loyalty programs, to exec comp, to relocation services, and so much more. You'll find pros in the vendor directory, a seemingly endless reserve of vetted, trusted HR providers. Visit worldatwork.org and take a look. Heidi Luerra is CEO and founder of Raw Artists, the world's largest independent arts organization. Raw serves independent artists with tools, resources, education, and exposure needed to thrive and succeed in their creative careers. Raw spotlights independent talent in visual arts, film, fashion and accessories design, music, performance art, beauty, crafts, tech, and photography. Heidi is also the author of The Work of Art, a no-nonsense field guide for creative entrepreneurs, which is available wherever books are sold. And she joins us now from Los Angeles. Hi, Heidi.
Hello. Thanks for having me.
Well, it's great to have you. Please say hello to my partner, Charles Epstein.
Hello, Charles.
Hey, Heidi. Thanks so much for taking time to join us. Much appreciated. By the way, before we begin, years ago, I did some work for a group called Gen Art. I don't know if they're still kicking. Are they still around? Are you familiar with those guys?
I am familiar. No, they are not around, sadly. I think they went out of business, I want to say, like 9 years ago. But they were definitely pioneers in this field, for sure.
Oh, okay. Any idea why they went south? It seemed like such a strong organization. We got involved with them. They just opened up a Miami base of operations, and we did some work for them, and they seem to be a really, really thriving, good organization, growing. So before we got on the phone with you, I went back to check them out, and it looked like they were dormant. So it's kind of surprised.
Yeah, I know. It was really sad to see. You're totally right. They're a really strong brand. I think they were, they got hit with the recession stuff and the sponsors. What I remember reading is that a large sponsor pulled out.
Oh, gee.
So it forced them to kind of shut down, unfortunately.
Okay, well, yeah, my intention wasn't to begin this conversation with a post-mortem, so.
Put that at the end.
My apologies. Anyway, getting right to Raw, is it fair to describe Raw as an incubator for artists? Mostly technology incubators where startups are housed and nurtured, and at a certain point they move out and move on. Is that how it works at Raw?
We describe ourselves more as a community. We're both an online and offline community. We're made up of almost 200,000 artists across the U.S., Australia, Canada, and Mexico. Mexico is our most recent city that we operate in, but we have showcases in each of these cities. So our mission is to provide tools, resources, exposure, and education to independent artists. We believe that they can have thriving careers, but they need to, you know, take steps to put themselves out there, et cetera. So our showcase events are kind of the exposure part of our mission. And then by joining our community, we have a very robust online platform that each artist has a profile on where they can post their music, photos of their work, links to their social media, and kind of build from there. And then we have, when they join our community, they go through a process in preparing for the showcase that is very educational and helpful. So a lot of our artists are within the first 10 years of their career. We don't discriminate, though. People definitely come to our showcases and wanted to become involved in our community that have been doing this for much longer. Mm-hmm. But, yeah, that's how we operate. We operate in 80 cities. Around the globe, and we typically host our showcases full of all of the crafts that you just mentioned, film, fashion, music, art, performing art, on a quarterly basis in each of these cities for the most part. So every major metropolitan city you can think of, we have a showcase available for artists to come and collaborate and join. Mm.
And as far as the Mexico connection, I guess occasionally they do send their best people. Moving right along.
So Heidi, I know that you were a fashion designer before starting Raw. What kind of work did you do?
Yeah, when I was 19, I started my own clothing line. It was an interchangeable trim line, kind of a weird fashion innovation, if you will. And I started, that's how all of this started, how Raw started, how everything started, was I was a young, hungry fashion designer looking for opportunities to showcase and sell my clothing line. And I wanted to go direct to market. I certainly wasn't, you know, ready for a showroom or any big retail opportunities. It was more I wanted to sell directly to my customer, and especially because my line was very customizable, et cetera. So I was looking for opportunities. And back in 2005, when I had my first showcase, there wasn't anything like this. Gen Art did exist. But I would argue I wasn't even ready for that. They're much more fashion week, you know, kind of driven. So I wanted something that was down to earth, grassroots, you know, people to art to people type of a thing. And it just didn't exist. So I had friends that were in the fashion industry that were also, you know, emerging designers. I had musician friends and artist friends. I mean, as you can imagine, in Los Angeles, there's a plethora of creative energy. So between all of that, everyone was, you know, kind of sharing my sentiments that, yeah, it kind of sucked that there wasn't a place to showcase. So I decided to do it myself. And I just thought it was going to be a one-time deal for myself and my friends. I was not expecting much other than to market my line and go direct to consumer. And we had about 750 people show up, and it became this kind of organic hit. And then people started coming to me after the first showcase thing. They wanted to be in the, at that point, non-existent next show. So that's kind of how it all started. It started with the clothing line and seeing kind of the need that I had myself. And I guess I took the, you know, be the change you want to see quote pretty literally.
Yeah. Yeah. Cause I was going to ask you what was next, what drove you to found Raw, but, that really kind of was the impetus for that.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. You know, you've got an impressive portfolio from film to fashion to music and tech. Two questions. Do you focus in any one or any several areas more than others? And two, well, you know what? Let's first answer number one, then I'll get to number two.
We don't necessarily focus any one direction per se. I think what's really unique about Raw is that we do put all these creative categories under one roof in one night. I will say most of our showcases have the largest area is the pop-up art gallery, where we have visual artists, we have sculptors, we have photographers, tech artists. We have accessory designers kind of all in this pop-up art gallery. So I will say that's kind of a large part of our showcases. If you walk in, that's like the first thing you'll see. And then there'll be a stage show happening with live music, and we'll cap the night with fashion shows. And in between there, kind of peppered into the show flow is performing artists going on stage. Mm-hmm. So it's a stage show simultaneously pop-up art gallery. But I will say, without there being a focus, the gallery is probably the largest portion of our show.
Interesting. Could you off the top name several of the artists who come through Raw who've broken through, who may be familiar to the general public?
Yes, actually. Just to name one off the bat, Vinny, I always butcher his last name, but I think Etienne is the correct way. He was just on Project Runway this last season and made it to the top 10, and he launched his line with Raw. But I always like to say, you know, he worked very hard. It's not because he participated in Raw that he is now where he is. It might have had, you know, some impact on his career, but we never make any promises that he could make artists famous or that, you know, we're the reason for their success. They all work really hard. We're just happy to kind of be a platform and a launch pad and something, you know, that can help them gain some confidence and some exposure and some experience, you know, really putting themselves out there.
Mm, interesting.
We're speaking with Heidi Luerra. She's the CEO and founder of Raw Artists, the world's largest independent arts organization. I'd like to talk about your book a bit, The Work of Art. It's a no-nonsense field guide for creative entrepreneurs. It's described as an honest, real-world guide for creatives seeking advice on jump-starting a creative business. I don't think people who think of themselves as artists and who are looking to have a career as an artist look at themselves as entrepreneurs, perhaps. But in order to succeed, it's kind of what you need to be. You have to wear a lot of hats, do things that you maybe don't like doing and think you're particularly good at. I assume that's largely what motivated you to write the book.
Absolutely. So being a creative myself, and I've also worked with creatives for going on almost 20 years at this point, I've just noticed different things that they do or don't do that can be harmful, you know, to long-term sustaining career. And I think those things are solvable, and you're absolutely right. Artists need to regard themselves as entrepreneurs and business owners and realize that, especially if they're an artist, as an individual, they are in and of themselves their brand. So there's a lot of mistakes that I've seen made, and I've made a ton myself too. I'm not perfect. So that was definitely the motivation for kind of putting all of this on paper. Is, you know, when I've read a ton of business books, being a business owner myself, but also in creative books, I always had a fashion design book in my back pocket when I was in school and as a kid, but tons of drawing books and creative books. And I don't think that artists need any more information on being more creative. I think they need information on how to have a sustainable career in creativity of any sort. And it's completely possible, and it's completely something that can be done, and I've done it myself. So I felt like I owed it to our community to share this information. It wouldn't be good to just keep it to myself. So yeah, that was really the motivation for writing this, is making sure that I could share those stories and the things that I did the wrong way, that they don't necessarily need to learn the hard way like I did. So yeah, I really think that creativity can change the world. I think incubating that is really important in our society. Creativity solves really big and small issues, and so I think it's really important.
We recently spoke with a woman, Emily Frank. She's a quote-unquote reinvention specialist, I believe. Is that how she bills herself? And she works with what she calls creative types, quirky creative types, although that may be a little bit redundant. And it occurred to me that, you know, maybe there was a business, accountants, maybe marketing people who specialize in working with quirky creative types. I wonder if there are any professional services firms out there who do that, who specialize in representing, well, not so much representing, there are enough of those people, but, you know, people who provide professional services and that kind of consultation for this segment. I wonder if there is such a thing.
I'm sure there is. I haven't seen a ton, to be honest. And I mean, I've worked in this field for a long time. I have seen some accountants and stuff that kind of maybe focus around that. But I think as far as professional development, there's definitely a gaping hole there. And that's something that Raw is really focused on, especially going into 2020. We're going to be super focused on making sure that our community is prepared on a business level, you know, to sustain themselves, even if they just want to do this as a hobby, to at least break even, you know, or to, you know, gain joy out of it, or decide that, you know, actually, I don't want to make this a business. I just want to do this for fun. Because I think that's another thing is there's a lot of artists that create where I think we're innately compelled to create as humans. And so oftentimes that happens and starts to unfold and unravel in that way. And you start creating things and you never really think about what your goal is and what you're doing it for and what might be a possibility, you know, as a result of creating. So, yeah. That's something that we are focused on because artists need it, you know, need it.
Yeah, for sure. I'm a fan of the writer Don Winslow. And what's really interesting is that he's really very supportive. I follow him on Twitter. He's very supportive of fellow writers. In fact, the Irish writer Adrian McGinty had fallen on hard times, and he put him in touch with his agent and got himself a seven-figure movie deal, et cetera, et cetera. And he's doing quite well. And he's always offering really sensible, practical advice for writers. Don't sign a five-book deal, because the publisher is always going to have you over a barrel. And writers, and I'm assuming artists in other fields, need that kind of practical advice because it's really, really rough. And if you don't have that, you're going to make mistakes that are really going to set your career back and may completely derail a career. So this kind of support is so important to nurture an artist.
Absolutely. And I feel like since I've kind of been on both sides of the track, I've been 100% creative, and then I started a business. I know how to disseminate this information in a way that's easy to understand, how I would wish somebody told me, you know?
Yeah.
So I hope it's helpful. I mean, that's the goal, is for the book to be a beneficial resource for artists and creatives of all types.
Yeah, no, it seems like a real valuable thing. With your background in fashion design and working with all the artists who come through Raw, what would you say are the two, three things that you wish you knew before starting a creative career, and by extension, that people starting their own creative careers ought to know?
You know, that's really funny. I think most people that are individual artists probably won't have to deal with some of the challenges that I have. But I think...
Excuse me, why do you say that?
Well, I have 60 employees in an office. I mean, maybe one day, you know, as an artist, as an individual, and obviously I'm talking specifically about visual art here, they might not have the same kind of struggles. But I think overarching struggles that I definitely have and share with these creative entrepreneurs and artists is, I think in the beginning, I kind of wanted it all, and I wanted it all right now. And I didn't know how patient I was going to have to be. So I think that's a struggle that, and kind of a mistake I made early on, because I began to feel like maybe I was unsuccessful because this wasn't happening right, you know, as soon as I could get it in my hot little hand, you know. which isn't the case. I think a lot of people need to realize that a creative career takes time, and it is sometimes two steps backward to get one step forward. And so I would say that's probably the first one and the first lesson that I learned the hard way. And I'm still learning in some ways that it just takes time. I would say the other thing that would parallel with creative as well is understanding money and finances and investing and saving and how all of that stuff works. That's stuff I did not want to deal with early on in my career. I shunned it, in fact. I just kind of like, nope, I don't want to do that. And that is an absolutely imperative thing, especially as creative people, that you have to learn if you want to have a sustainable business. So that, I made a lot of mistakes with that early on, just because I didn't really know how to do it. And I didn't, and my mistake there is like not seeking the answers early enough. I relied on other people or hired other people to do this and didn't really quite understand, and not having that sense of control of things is, you know, you need to rely on people, but you also can't be completely in the dark. Everything is your business when you own a business.
Oh no, that's for sure. That's for sure.
Yeah, and then you asked for three, right?
Well, if there are only two, if you can come up with a third, great. If you can come up with a fourth, even better.
Yeah, third, I would say. I think in my younger years, I also sometimes didn't have the best discretion, and I kind of partnered out of convenience with people on certain projects or whatever, or full businesses actually. But I would just assume, you know, I think one of the biggest mistakes that I made early on was just assuming that someone was going to come and save me and do all the work for me at some point. And if I partnered with this right person, or if I had that magazine spread, or if I had this, that it was just going to change my life, you know, and it doesn't. It really all comes down to you, and you have to be really smart about the people that you kind of let into your circle and your business and what you're creating overall. I would say those are the top three.
Do you have any associations with some well-known artists who come in to talk and mentor some of your people?
No, it's something that we've thought about doing. We do once a month, we have what we call industry exchange. And this is a live Instagram chat where we've had like an arts and entertainment lawyer come in. We've had people that represent music licensing come in. Because our spectrum is quite broad, we try and focus on the business side and the more general topics that business wants or that artists want to know. We do that, but we don't have a mentoring program as it stands now. I would like to implement that. We've talked about it several times, but it is quite an undertaking. It's a logistical puzzle because we have 200,000 artists in our network. But yeah, it's for sure a needed thing.
How does one apply? Is there a vetting process? I made an analogy to business incubators like Y Combinator. And, you know, it's very competitive and you are vetted and you have to clear certain hurdles. And if you're accepted, it's a big deal and you're on a fast track. Is there any kind of similar process?
Yeah, we have a curation team that fields submissions that come into our website or come in through social media. And we look at all of the artists and make sure that they're a good fit, basically participating in the showcase, and that they're good talent-wise and also professionally to a certain extent. Like, they've got to have some of their stuff together. But we're also for new and emerging artists, so we understand that not everyone's going to have all of the pieces, you know, right off the bat. They're not going to have, you know, always perfect professional photos of their work and things of that nature. That's something that comes with being a part of Raw. So, yes, we have a curation department that looks through all of those artists.
And how many artists did you say you're in your network?
Almost 200,000 across.
Oh, my goodness. Wow. Wow.
Yeah. That's well, amazing. We've been going for 10 years. So.
Yeah, but still, that's impressive. Yeah. And you said what, in 60 countries? Do I have that right?
No. We're in the United States, Canada, Australia, and most recently Mexico City as of last fall. In Guadalajara, we just launched in Guadalajara.
Where did I come up with 60? I must have spent a little too much time in the sun earlier today. I'm sorry.
No,
I'm sorry.
City. I mean, I would love to be in 60 countries. That would be great. I'd love to see what the art is looking like in South Africa and Greenland. And,
oh, and yeah, for sure.
There's so much out there.
Yeah, I'm assuming, you know, your business is actually kind of scalable. Would there be any kind of barriers for you to get into those other countries?
The hardest one is the right person to run it. The way that, you know, taxes and laws work, we can't do it ourselves. So we need a licensee in each of the countries that we're in. And they kind of run it like their own business under our umbrella. So, that's the hardest part, is finding the right person that has the creative brain, but also the entrepreneurial chops, because in the beginning, it is a lot of sweat equity as we start. So that's been the challenge. And also, I mean, it's an overcomable challenge, but language barriers and things of that nature.
Right.
We have a very robust back-end system that, you know, we have all of our own proprietary technology to kind of run this and make sure that it's as efficient and effective as possible. And so with that, every time we change anything or need to do the whole thing in French, it is a big, it's a big deal.
Oh, yeah.
So when we launch in Montreal, for instance, or Mexico, you know, all of our packets and promotional materials and everything has to be translated. So it's quite a big undertaking. We don't open countries lightly. We've gone pretty slow with it. But yeah, that's something that I want to do. I would love to see Raw everywhere. I think it would be awesome. Because another thing our artists get to do through being a part of our network is they can go and showcase in Australia and have a similar experience, in the sense that they know what to expect. They know about what the crowd size is going to be. They know what their setup is like. So we've had artists tour through our network, which has been super cool to see.
Neat stuff.
That's great. Yeah. Well, Heidi, we really do appreciate your time today. Thank you so much for taking the time to join us.
Absolutely. It's my pleasure.
Heidi Luerra is CEO and founder of Raw Artists, the world's largest independent arts organization. She's also an author. The Work of Art, a no-nonsense field guide for creative entrepreneurs, which is available wherever books are sold. And Heidi spoke to us today from Los Angeles. And we'll be back right after these words.
You're listening to Work in Progress with Tom Alexander and Charles Epstein.
What to do when you need external HR expertise? Head on over to World at Work's vendor directory, kind of like the Yelp of HR, but without the biases. It's where to turn when you're looking for resources and providers in the world of HR. From legal services to compensation management, to loyalty programs, to exec comp, to relocation services, and so much more. You'll find pros in the vendor directory, a seemingly endless reserve of vetted, trusted HR providers. Visit worldatwork.org and take a look.
Wrapping things up right now on Work in Progress, along with Charles Epstein, I'm Tom Alexander, and a lot of fun talking with Heidi Luerra today.
Yes, and I do hope that she appreciates the play that we played her on with a little Iggy Pop. Thought that was completely appropriate, but really, it's a terrific platform that she has going there, because as we know full well, the artists we've known, artists we love, and artists we've read about, many of them just don't have those entrepreneurial chops. And most artists are ultimately entrepreneurs. They need to manage their business. And I think what she's doing and inculcating those skills is a terrific service.
No question about it. And I'll tell you, I should run my jazz piano up the flagpole over there. Let's see what the heck happens. You know, maybe she could get me a couple of gigs.
Yes. Well, at the very least, maybe she could help you write a business plan, work up some marketing strategy, and who knows? Maybe that's just the thing you need to get out there.
I love it.
You know, but in any case, coming back to Megan Rapinoe, again, huge bummer. Hopefully we'll get her back. We do understand that she was a big hit in Philadelphia, keynoting and hanging out and signing soccer balls and jerseys. Again, you know, maybe at some point we'll have her on, and because there are just so many topics we'd love to discuss with her.
Absolutely. And speaking of Philadelphia, next week, one of our guests includes Mark Zumoff, and he is the voice, the television voice, of the Philadelphia 76ers. So that'll be a lot of fun. Looking forward to speaking to him.
Oh, yeah, absolutely, particularly since they're a real legitimate championship contender. And I'd love to talk to him about the championship culture they've developed there, how Joel Embiid is managing to mesh with former Celtics player and nemesis, now teammate, Al Horford, and a lot of other subplots going on there. That should be really interesting. I'm looking forward to that. And yeah. I know, of course, you know, you being a lifelong Philly fan have already a built-in interest.
Oh, without a question. And I'm a big fan of him personally. He just does a great job. No matter what team you root for, you know, those great announcers, you have to appreciate them no matter what team they're with. And Mark is terrific. So I'm looking forward to that.
Yeah.
So anyway, that's it, Charles. Another show wrapped up, show number 28. And We keep moving forward.
Indeed we do.
This is Work in Progress. He's Charles Epstein. I'm Tom Alexander. We thank you so much for listening, and we'll see you next time right here. So long, everybody.
This has been Work in Progress, a World at Work podcast about work, life, and everything in between, with award-winning radio host Tom Alexander and Workspan's Not Safe for Work columnist Charles Epstein. For more, visit worldatwork.org/workinprogress. That's worldatwork.org/workinprogress. Join us next week for another edition of Work in Progress.